So, right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Perdana University's bi-monthly luncheon address. On the floor today, we have Yang Bahagia Datuk Dr. Sheikh Ahmad bin Hussein, the Vice-Chancellor of Perdana University. Our speaker today, Professor Dr. Krishna Gopal Rampal, Dean of Perdana University Graduate School of Medicine. Deans of school, head of departments, ladies and gentlemen, once again, a warm and a pleasant welcome. I believe an applause, isn't there? So on behalf of Perdana University, it gives me great pleasure to welcome each and every one of you to our first ever bi-monthly luncheon address. So reminiscing on the 1966 Wittenoom tragedy, Western Australia, and many more perhaps quieter reportings around the world, one could just help to wonder the controversies and debates that have grown over this issue that we're going to talk about it today. So as an attempt to shed some light on this matter, it is only apt for the Perdana University's bi-monthly luncheon address to commence with the theme Asbestos Control, Are We Doing Enough? So without further ado, please join me in inviting Professor Dr. Krishna Gopal Rampal to deliver his speech. Please, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon. Firstly, I'd like to thank Dr. Said for initiating this PU lunch series. I think it's an interesting initiative, and also like to thank Puan Norpisa for driving it. Dr. Said has initiated it. I'm sure Puan Norpisa, who is the acting registrar, has been driving everybody. And I'm also honored actually to be given this opportunity to talk on a subject that I've liked as the first speaker in this particular series. Now, you wonder why I chose this topic. I've been actually involved in the issues related around asbestos since the early 80s. My first incident was actually taking my students from UKM as part of the factory visit to asbestos plants in Petaling Jaya. And at that time, of course, control measures were very little. Workers were coming in, asbestos bags used to come in, opened by the workers, open exposure, very little control measures in place. Then, of course, another journey was in 85, now it was 30 years ago, I was invited to sit on the committee when they were developing the asbestos regulations in this country. The asbestos factories and machinery asbestos regulations came out in 86, and I was involved in the committee that was looking into it. 2 years later, of course, I was at Hopkins at that time, and I kind of wrote a paper which we kind of presented at the International Pneumoconiosis Conference in 87. On comparing the ILO Convention 86 on asbestos, the US asbestos standard, which also came out in 86, and our own regulations that came out in 86. When I came back in early 89, I do remember meeting as a representative from the Department of the Factories and Machinery Department, visiting the committee that looks at asbestos. There was a South Pacific Asbestos Association Committee, Employer Federation. And I remember asking the chairman of that committee, about the situation about the asbestos in the country, and he says, Dr. Rampal, there is no asbestos-related disease in this country. Hard to believe, but he says there's no published data on this. And many years later, a lot of that is still true. A lot of it is still not very much published. Then, of course, when that happened, right, we said, okay, why don't we now start documenting some of this? I worked with actually an advisor to the asbestos injury who was already collecting data, nearly about 1,000 individuals who had, he had the chest x-rays, he had the lung function test, and we published a kind of first paper on asbestos and also reported on asbestos-related diseases. In the last decade, my colleagues from Japan had introduced what is called the Asia Asbestos Initiative among academics to highlight this problem about asbestos and pushing for us to also work towards a ban. Even in the early 90s or late 80s, when the Consumer Association of Penang and the MTUC kind of pushed for a ban in this country, right? I kind of was working with the MMA at that time and kind of also promoting a ban. And I remember very clearly, in these early meetings in the 90s, early 90s, they told me asbestos will be banned soon. And now it's 2015, and asbestos has not been banned in Malaysia yet. And that is why I asked this question, right? And a friend of mine says, are we doing enough? And he says, maybe we have done enough. I said, no. Until there's a ban on asbestos in this country, following many developed countries, I think it is time that we work towards it. The contents of my presentation are basically, I'll talk to you about asbestos because the crowd is mixed and its users, about asbestos-related diseases, efforts that have been made globally as well as in Malaysia to eliminate asbestos-related diseases, and what are the challenges in preventing diseases associated with asbestos as well as managing that, as well as some recommendations. For those who do not know, asbestos basically fibers exist in two groups. One are the serpentine group, which is a long, thin, snake-like fibers, right? And that you can see up here, right? Basically, and that's mainly chrysotile or white asbestos. And then we have this amphibole group, which are needle-like kind of thing. And you've got your blue asbestos, your brown asbestos, which is amosite out here. Why is asbestos so useful? It has actually been used for many, many years now. Right, some would say more than 2,500 years ago, it's already in use. Why? As a product, it's very good. It's a lot of good properties. It's indestructible, inextinguishable. Right? And actually, commercial entities have now taken it for commercial uses for many years now. Historically, of course, used in building materials, used as textile materials to embalm pharaohs, to seal log cabins in the Scandinavian countries, to wrap bodies for cremation. Imagine now, you've got an asbestos textile material, you go in for cremation, the body gets burnt, cremated, but then you can reuse the cloth that is been used for this purpose. For all ends and purposes, most of us would see asbestos in our cement products, in our roof tiles, in our ceilings, in our floor tiles. Also in insulation material, at the back of your refrigerator, or asbestos textiles, for those who remember going out to the cinema halls in this country and you had the very thick curtains that were there. Right? A lot of these thick curtains had asbestos in them to basically act as fireproof, fire retardant measures. And most common now, what is left of this industry is mainly being used in brake lining, gaskets, and in clutch plates. Now, to be exposed, of course, there must be a source. Right? And where do these workers get exposed? In Malaysia, of course, we do not mine asbestos. Right? And most countries actually have moved away from mining for asbestos because of the hazards associated with it. But they continue to use it in their manufacture of asbestos-containing products. In Malaysia, we continue to do that in our asbestos cement products, and our tiles and roof and ceilings. The construction industry, a lot of people forget that asbestos is already there in our homes, in the buildings in this country. And whenever the construction industry workers in the construction industry go out there and they disturb it, they want to renovate, they have to remove it. And no precautions are basically taken, I guess. So in effect, sometimes you'll see very commonly outside your house, a house being renovated, it's got this asbestos cement, some of the ceilings that are out there. Out there, this whole kind of debris that's out there. And not only they get affected, but also the passerbys. Those mechanics who work in motor vehicle shops get exposed to it. Those who are shipbuilding, involved in demolishing ships, A lot of asbestos was used in insulation pipes and ships, a lot of exposure there. And of course, also in other trade, in the cement workers. This is what it looks like. Your white asbestos, chrysotile, your blue asbestos, crossodolite, and your brown asbestos. And this is actually the amphiboles, very sharp, needle-like kind of expression. So these are the other, you can see how these exposures are occurring. And this was the kind of situations in the 80s in this country too. And I remember getting out to the plants and seeing. The good thing, of course, after the 86 regulation, a lot of measures were taken. So when I went back into the industry in the early 90s, we already were seeing changes that were happening. Okay. I like this particular slide. The facilities people tell me there's asbestos in the ceiling. They say you don't need to worry about it unless it gets disturbed, and that's what a lot of people will say. And of course, they plan to disturb it today. A lot of times they believe that if you've got asbestos out there and it's already in the system, in the material, nothing to worry. It's only when you go and damage it, you disturb it, then people do get exposed. Now, as a result of exposure to asbestos, we see all these exposures occurring in many situations, right? Diseases occur, people get diseased from it. And the common conditions are those that are either specific to asbestos, that means you do not see it if there's no asbestos exposure, or only see it when there's asbestos exposure. So for example, asbestosis, mesothelioma, and pleural plaques are only seen when somebody is specifically exposed to asbestos. However, right, individuals can get lung cancer, of course, without being exposed to asbestos, but exposure to asbestos increases the risk of developing lung cancer. Also pleural thickening, pleural effusion, pleural plaques, that are out there. For those who are not medically trained, I guess it's very important for us to understand what the pleural abnormalities are. There's pleural thickening, pleural calcification, pleural plaques. This is your pleural lining out there, and you can see these plaques, the small here, this lesion that's out here. Or here also you see pleural plaques and of course going on to thicker plaques out there. The good thing about, the interesting thing about pleural thickening and pleural plaques, of course, there's a good correlation between pleural plaques and asbestos bodies in the lung, right? The only question that people do ask is whether, let's say we do see pleural plaques, whether there will be increased risk of developing pleural mesothelioma, and that relationship has actually not been shown yet, right? So one, we see pleural changes, then of course the most common historically, but now rapidly declining even in this country, basically are the fibrotic diseases as a result of exposure to asbestos. And the reason it's declining in incidence is it depends on the intensity and duration of exposure. More and more countries, more and more individuals, the exposures have declined, and the durations of exposure have declined, so we see less and less of that, right? But what is important to know is the treatment does not reverse the progression of disease. Whatever changes have occurred, they will continue to occur. The changes will remain. And here, because it is dose dependent, it has become very, very important to one, of course, if you ban it, that will be the best, but at least reduce exposures. And my concern is that what is happening in recent years, while the developed countries have stopped using it or have reduced tremendously the exposures, a lot of asbestos is getting exported to Indonesia, to Thailand, to Vietnam, right? Source of income for those exporters, but increasingly happen. And that's why the Asian Asbestos Initiative was very worried about this thing that's happening. The third, of course, is lung cancer, right? And all of you know that smoking, of course, increases the risk of lung cancer 10 times, right? And those, of course, who are exposed to asbestos alone, their risk of lung cancer is 5 times. And there's a multiplicative risk, interestingly enough, that if you're exposed to asbestos and you're also a smoker, then the risk is about 50 times. So the rule of the game is, one, don't smoke. Two, all right, if you do smoke, please do not work in the asbestos industry. Very clear. Because the risk now is multiplicative, it's not an additive risk, right? And there's quite a linear relationship between lung cancer and cumulative exposure. And historically, whenever they talked about lung cancer, they used to say it's only associated with crossidolite or the amphiboles, but not with chrysotile. Increasingly, the evidence is very clear that lung cancer is also a mesothelioma associated with chrysotile, the serpentine form. All right? And most of the time, this is what I always get worried about when we talk about lung cancer. So on one side, we hear increasing incidence of lung cancer. And then I calculate the number of lung cancer cases in the country. And then they tell me about 5% of lung cancer cases would be attributable to asbestos. However, when I go to the compensation board, SOCSO, look for claims, no claim for lung cancer as a result of asbestos exposure. Very poor history taking. Associations not being made. So on one side, you're saying, hey, lung cancer, think about asbestos exposure also, about 5%, 3%, whatever. But still, we should see. But we do not get them at all. All right? And that worries me. And for this, of course, the Helsinki criteria has been used for the diagnosis of lung cancer and attributing it to asbestos exposure. Finally, of course, a very sad condition, because the life expectancy of an individual who develops mesothelioma, 6 months, 1 year, 1.5 years, long latency period. So people don't even know that they were exposed to asbestos historically. And of course, these mesotheliomas occur in the pleura and then in the peritoneum, all right, occurring both exposure to chrysotile as well as the amphiboles, right? 18% of all mortality in are due to mesothelioma. That means the moment you've got crocidolite workers, but 1/5 of them are going to get mesothelioma. Very clear. Alright? Because of the long latency that's out there, right, individuals will not even remember that they were exposed to asbestos. And this, the interesting thing, of course, because what is this question is always there. There's a group out there which believes there's a threshold for any exposure to cause disease. But a lot of also individuals believe, at least in the context of asbestos, the context of course, there is no threshold. That means even if an individual was exposed to asbestos for a short time, right? After that, no further exposure, 20, 30 years later, may develop mesothelioma. And the sad part, because he does not remember the exposure, doctors do not record it down, he does not get his compensation. Okay? Now, what is the burden of asbestos-related diseases out there? About 107 deaths caused by mesothelioma, asbestos lung cancer, and asbestosis every year, out of which 43,000 mesothelioma deaths alone, all right? And 7,000 deaths that are there that are occurring due to asbestosis. Of course, asbestosis deaths will decline, but the mesothelioma deaths, lung cancer deaths will continue to increase. In fact, we are now beginning, I was told by Ken, a friend of mine from Japan, in Malaysia we should see about 50 cases of mesothelioma a year. However, maybe 2 cases get reported, 1 case, and the figures that he kind of extrapolates on. The good thing, of course, is that the use of asbestos has declined, right, from its peak, but globally, still, 2 million metric tons are still used, all right, and the current and future burden of these diseases, nobody really knows. Estimates are done, and individuals are working on this that's out there. Globally, now what has been done? As I talked about asbestos, I've told you where it's used, right? And I also told you about the health effects from asbestos exposure. The worldwide, right? I remember in the 70s, there was a very interesting book called Outrageous Misconduct. And this was a book basically written trying to say how the asbestos industry knew about asbestos exposure and disease. Because as early as 1928, asbestosis was already reported. In the 1930s, lung cancer associated asbestos already reported. 60s, Wagner already reported the whole case series about asbestos and mesothelioma. However, the asbestos industry tried to hide that fact. 1. 2, continued to insist that at least in the context, the chrysotile is safe, maybe the amphiboles are not. Right? So in that whole context that was out there. The ILO, it was interesting in 1986, that what I had mentioned to you earlier, the ILO had come out with its own convention, OSHA had come out with its own US asbestos standard, and in Malaysia, our own factories and machinery asbestos process regulations were introduced. At a global level, there was a Dresden Declaration in 2003 itself, calling for a worldwide ban. The ILO and a WHO committee that sat in the same year, following the Dresden Declaration, decided that they will move towards concerted worldwide effort to eliminate asbestos-caused diseases. They were quite clear. And the route they decided was actually to move towards a ban and whatever initial steps to be taken. And the EU directive also talked about banned sale and use of asbestos-containing products by 2005. the unions, global unions, already had called for a ban in 2006, called ILO for that to go on, right? However, I must say, the developing countries always very reluctant. Always, I guess the message they were being fed, I guess that's what you would like to say, the message they were being fed is it will be very hard, very expensive, very difficult for you to replace asbestos with other products. But except for the brake lining and all that, and for all ends and purposes, there are a lot of alternative products already available as alternatives for asbestos, right? How the asbestos industry works? In fact, Canada, which was basically one of the main producers, South Africa, Canada, and even Australia, right, which has now kind of stopped, right, blocked whatever inclusion of chrysotile on the UN list of highly dangerous substances. See, there's a list of highly dangerous substances. Any country which is exporting this to any other country is required to inform the member country, that country, of the hazards that are associated with this. So whenever any attempts were made to include chrysotile into this list, Canada opposed it. So in fact, as early as 2005, right, there was a free trade. I mean, France wanted to actually introduce legislation with regards to asbestos. However, not successful. Canada tried to take this free trade authority, free trade, as a reason that you cannot include. But France went ahead and said, for health reasons, we will do it. Right? But the good news is that only in 2012, late, Canadian government announced it would no more block inclusion of chrysotile in the Rotterdam Convention. So that was a good sign. That is to say, anybody wanted to export asbestos to Indonesia, Malaysia, Vietnam, Cambodia, wherever, were at least required to inform them that this is in this list, these are the health effects from this, right? And even the Australian Parliament also decided to actually work towards eradication. You must remember, Australia was one of the early producers of asbestos, right? And while asbestos exports from developed to developed countries are there, and some would say, hey, continuing, and some will say increasing in some parts of the world. Asbestos has to go somewhere. For the producers, it had to go somewhere. It's money, right, to be made. I like this particular slide. Canadian asbestos exports out there, sending it to a developing country, and all this guy has got this. And they say, what did they use? They use the word safe use of asbestos, right? That is to say, we imagine that these workers would be given adequate respiratory protection. And idea is that the message that went on until this ban came about was what is called promoted safe use of asbestos. That means to say, the employers will make sure that they will reduce the exposure levels to below the permissible exposure level, right? That's what will be done. And two, personal protective equipment will be given. But in reality, in developing countries, you do not have that personal protection. The respirators that are used, all right, were not adequate enough. Right, so you would see this in this example that's out there. Workers on one side, if they are individuals in the developed countries using asbestos, this is the kind of protection they would give, and this guy would be maybe given a handkerchief or a towel to use. All right, this is another nice slide I thought. Asbestos producers and exporters, thanks to the efforts of the federal government, we will continue to make a killing. That's what is the whole thing. Of course, for asbestos producers and exporters, all right, because when they block that, for the Rotterdam Convention, asbestos industry, of course, made money. And another nice cartoon here for your zero asbestos tolerance, where it really matters. All right, what happens here? Asbestos industry out there, what is it doing? Pushing the dust, asbestos, the dust, fiber, and saying, oh, fiber in the diet is good for you. I guess asbestos got fibers, all right? And that's what happens. Currently, there are 55 countries, 54 and one more, all right, already listed, already having bans on asbestos. Very clear. So countries slowly have to move to, are moving towards this ban, and most of the developed countries have already gone and banned asbestos, and there's a whole ban asbestos secretary which is monitoring these changes that are happening. That was globally. You had the Dresden Declaration, you had the Rotterdam Convention that's out there, you had each of the trade unions making a move towards kind of banning asbestos. Now, what has been going on in this country? Right? I think it's very important for us to know. Asbestos, of course, is not mined in Malaysia, for us to be very clear on that. In Canada, it's mined, but most of it is exported. In Australia, it was mined, most of it exported. Very clear, right? Even in Malaysia now, who started this industry, the asbestos cement industry? joint venture companies between Australia and a joint venture company from Australia and a Malaysian company, a joint venture company from Japan and a Malaysian company, set up this first asbestos cement industries out there to manufacture roofing, flat shields, pipes, friction materials. Right? And of course, when the information about the hazards associated with asbestos became more and more common, then the government decided, hey, I think we need to at least have regulations, called the asbestos process regulations, to be introduced. All right? Now, once this happened, of course, the other legislation that came about, of course, for some of you may know, is a replacement of the Factories and Machinery Act. There was the Occupational Safety and Health Act, and something called the OSHA Use and Standards of Exposure to Chemicals Hazardous to Health. For those in the audience today from Ireland, all right, the legislation in Malaysia has been very similar to what has happened in the UK. We had a Factories and Machinery Act, which is very similar to what is happening in the UK. Then, in 1994, we have the Occupational Safety and Health Act introduced in this country, which was equivalent to the Health and Safety at Work Act in 1974 in the UK. Then, when we had our own Use and Standards of Exposure to Chemicals regulations in 2000, it was very reflective of what is called the COSH regulations in the UK. So for those who know, the COSH regulations came out in the late 80s, all right? And by 92, there's already other directives from the European Union that came about. So what we did in Malaysia was basically have a lag time. You introduce a regulation, 10 years later we are down there. 15 years later we do the same thing, right? And what is obvious now, of course, there's decline in the use of asbestos, right? However, we all working in Malaysia for many years now, continuing putting pressure to ban asbestos. I think one of the few times I went on TV to fight a cause, because normally I've been working in the university and I've always been very kind of independent. I would go to the unions, speak at the conferences, I'll talk to the employer federations and tell them why I do not like what they're doing, right? And mainly in the context of take an independent stand. But this was the only reason actually I kind of took my thing. I said, I think this was early 90s already, I went on TV and I said, hey, I think we need to ban asbestos. It's too long. And 20 years later now, nothing's still there, right? When is it expected? Nobody knows. Because every time I'm told next year, next year, next year, and after a while you get tired, okay? In Malaysia, of course, various acts and regulations very similar. The safety and OSHA, which is equivalent to your Health and Safety at Work Act, your Use and Standards equivalent to your COSH regulations in the UK. All right, your NADOPOD is basically equivalent to your RIDOR regulations that are there. So we are very good in cut and paste. We do not like to waste time. We learn fast. We kind of, you know, because a lot of times it's easier to do that. All right, and we call it modify. We modify whatever is used out there. And of course, the labeling regulation, the class regulation that came out last 2 years ago. What is important for this country in the context of this? They have very good guidelines available for chemicals. And especially now we have this particular guideline on the chemical health risk assessment that was done, the CHRA that is required. And down the road, you will see the HIRAC guidelines. In the UK, in 1992, they had already equivalent to the HIRAC kind of thing, and the COSH already in 2000. So we were actually about 14 years, sometimes I've said 11 years for the use regulation, and for the HIRAC, another 16 years in delay. But overall, I must say, we got very good guidelines. We also have a nice system of registering assessors, and we also created this in 2000, something called occupational health doctor. Let me spend 1 minute on this. In 91, I started a course called introductory course in occupational medicine. And all I did was, the director at that time told me from the factories machinery, let's start a rumor that doctors who want to practice, do medical surveillance in industrial, must be trained in occupational health. And that's what we did. Started a rumor. And from that, from a 9-day introductory course, we went on to develop postgraduate diploma, master's, PhD. And now, since 2000, any medical practitioner who wants to do medical surveillance for chemicals hazardous to health in this country is required to have some occupational health training and is then registered to the Department of Safety and Health to be an occupational health doctor. Okay. Now, of course, now I'm pushing for another level is for doctors to be fully employed by industry because they've got a certain number of employees out there. Within this system, of course, for the asbestos, they also have guidelines on medical surveillance to be done every year. For asbestos exposed workers, the chest x-rays to be done every 3 years, right? And of course, those individuals who have got suspected asbestosis, chest x-ray to be repeated a year later, and if it's definite, then the chest x-rays get annually. Sometimes I'm not very excited about this annually and all that, because sometimes I'm not so sure how useful they are. I know in the US they say the lag time of 10 years before you even start doing the chest x-rays, but this medical surveillance must be done by individuals who are now trained. And the records are to be kept for 30 years. My problem is records are not going to be kept for 30 years. Even if you go back to the GPs who are running this, record keeping is poor. Employers are supposed to keep it. Employers change hand. Because I think it was late 90s when the Department of Safety and Health at that time called in the asbestos industry. I was involved in it. They said, can you take out your medical records and let's have a look at what's happening? They couldn't. They didn't want to. Right? And of course, there are medical removal provisions. Now, what do we go from here? Right? And what has been done in addition to all the regulatory mechanisms that's out there? Of course, when we think about in the workplace itself, this whole question of ban versus safe use. Asbestos industry, they would love to use the word safe use. Safe use maybe in the developed world, mechanisms in place, legislation in place, enforcement good, maybe can work. I am not so sure it works very well. So if in any mechanism in occupational health, we use this word hierarchy of controls. And you start up with eliminating the hazard, substituting the hazard, using engineering controls, using administrative controls, then using PPE as a last measure. So to me, if I want to eliminate the hazard, work towards getting it banned. Or at least for the companies out there, to move towards not using it at all, eliminating the hazard by not buying, right? Not using it. And of course, for substituting with other asbestos-free mineral fibers, good engineering controls, right? Providing shower and laundry facilities. The good thing with the asbestos regulations when it came out, I remember, historically workers who used to work in the asbestos industry would come in, and I'm sure those who are involved in this work would come in, work home clothes, work there, and go back with the same home clothes, right? And I think it's in Molly Newhouse in 1966 already showed that when workers went home, the children also get exposed to this and are also at risk for developing cancers. Right? So here at least what they did was have laundry machines within the plant itself. So it's not that the worker now will use his clothes, home clothes, come to work, go back with the same clothes, children, family members also exposed. At least that was reduced with that. And of course when you talk about PPE, what historically used to be given was normal face mask or towel, whatever. Not acceptable. There's a whole range depending on the levels of exposure, whether you have a full face mask or a half face mask. Respirators, and of course if exposures are very high, then maybe air supply respirators too. Over the years, it has become clear that we do have asbestos in our midst, in these buildings that are out there. In fact, the UK, the parliament had asbestos. Each of these old buildings have asbestos. And now a friend of mine was just telling me they're involved in renovating the parliament in Malaysia. And I asked her this question, this is just last week. Right? Is there asbestos in there? She says, I've just been appointed as the industrial hygienist, and they've not been able to tell me that. Right? And to me, that's worrying. Right? Because it is when you are now disturbing it, you're renovating it, breaking some of that, right? You need to do. And whenever that kind of activities are going on, look at this measures that are taken. Negative ventilation, individuals fully clothed, fully gowned, that's not happening. The contract worker is sent out. Who's this contract worker? Indonesia, from Bali, from Indonesia, from Bangladesh, from wherever. He's going to come in. He's going to do the work. Nobody's going to even monitor what happens to him. But that's the truth. Even in our own houses which are renovated, if there was asbestos out there, you call your contractor, he's not going to get his workers dressed up, in this kind of suiting that's out there to remove and encapsulate or enclose. I had mentioned something in my abstract about asbestos cement pipes. The WHO many years ago came up with this very clear statement that asbestos cement pipes are safe. Okay? Because the asbestos will not leach into the water system and the risk of drinking water with asbestos is very, very small. However, we know that over the years, these asbestos cement pipes get damaged, right? And there's a probability of some of the asbestos fibers in the pipes getting into the drinking water. So in Malaysia, the last few years, a lot of efforts are now being taken to replace the old asbestos cement pipes, right, with non asbestos material that's out there. Good sign. If let's say, I've told you about the diseases now, let's say if an individual now does get disease, I'm glad to say that SOCSO, the Employer Social Security Organization here in this country, basically provides compensation. There is a list of occupational diseases, which is the fifth schedule of the Act, the Social Security Act, right, 1969, Employee Social Security 1969, and they've included pneumoconiosis, lung cancer, or mesothelioma caused by asbestos in this list. Why I'm also actually, it's also deja vu for me, because what happened was in 1985, when I produced this paper on silica, which got used for the mineral dust regulations, at that time, SOCSO's list for compensation did not include any occupational lung disease. Somehow got missed. And I guess at that time, in our effort to push for the silicosis in to be included, we got all the other occupational lung diseases also got included into this. So for me, it's a nice journey that I've taken. Right. The only problem with this regulation, I mean this list was, the disease must come within 60 months after ceasing employment. And we know, for asbestos-related disease, there's a long latency period. Your pleural plaques, pleural changes will occur in about 10 to 15 years. Your asbestosis, 15 to 20 years. Your lung cancer, 20 years, 30 years. Your mesothelioma is 30 to 40 years. So you're not going to see these changes immediately. If anybody is going to claim, it will be found beyond the 5 years. So however, I must say, SOCSO has been quite supportive of all claims that come in. And they will understand the situation. But under the Act itself, they say any disease within must be within 60 months of ceasing employment. The amount of compensation these workers get will depend on something called the special medical board. In Malaysia, we have something called a special medical board, which will look into cases of occupational diseases to decide about the amount of compensation. The amount of compensation given is generally related, for those who are very familiar with the American Medical Association guidelines on impairment, permanent impairment, in Malaysia, the Social Security Organization has developed its own guidelines, but very much based on the AMA guide. In fact, we used to use the fourth edition at the time. Now we have modified it for the sixth edition of the AMA guide. And in the context of compensation, we link it with the AMA guide to this country. About insurance, one last thing. Our health insurance doesn't cover mesothelioma. When can you start? This is an individual coming to the asbestos industry to work. Okay, that means to say the only risk you're going to be exposed to, sorry, not covered. And a question being asked, don't you feel guilty withholding money from the asbestos victims? I like this. They can't take it with them. Mesothelioma, 6 months, 1 year, 1.5 years, gone. Okay. Now, in summary, in the last three slides I have, I just want to talk about what are the challenges that basically that are out there, right, in this context. In preventing, and then about managing this disease. One, I think there's lack of awareness about the health effects of asbestos. This even among the policymakers, and I'll tell you why. Each time when we have talked about banning asbestos, they say, hey, can you please show me how many cases are there of asbestos-related disease? Two, three, none. They say, why should we ban? Maybe, and the sad part was, one of the doctors who was working in that organization told me, maybe this disease doesn't exist in Malaysians. Maybe it occurs in other parts of the world. Doesn't make sense. But I was getting worried when policymakers start thinking like that. Two, healthcare professionals, right? Then, of course, those who supply these products that are there, and most important are the employers and employees. With asbestos, I must say, however, there are very clear training and education provisions within the regulations, and now even within the use regulations that are out there, very clear, employers need to inform employees every year, do training and all that. But the problem is not there. We have got good legislation to do that, but the enforcement, poor. Nobody, not strict. Engineering controls are put, but employers usually reluctant to spend money on engineering controls. So believe PPE is the easier way to go. But the particular problem with respirators, for those who have used respirators, it's not like a simple mask, not like a surgical mask. It's a respirator. It's got a dead space. You need to have good, you need to be able to breathe well. And a lot of times, it's a very uncomfortable because you need to breathe better. Two, not only that, it's also very warm inside. So after a few minutes, you take out the respirator. And what happens, even a short period of time you do not use a respirator, effectiveness of this protection gone. Okay? So yes, of course, this good PPE program very, very important. That is to say, not only supplying them to use, but also making sure they use. And of course, because under the use regulation, there's a CHRA that's out there, and somehow I must say, the CHRA's chemical health risk assessments that are done are poor in quality and sometimes not well advised. That was in preventing, but in managing asbestos-related disease, that means after it's occurred, the occupational health doctor was out there, right? Only 9 days of training. How is he going to know all about the issues about any of these particular diseases? However, we say it is educate enough to do medical surveillance. That means he must know he needs to have a chest, he needs to take a medical occupational smoking history, he needs to have a lung function test done, he needs to get an x-ray, x-rays need to be reported by ILO classification, those kind of things. Alright? So he knows what the issues to be taken. The problem is that most places occupational history is very incomplete. The lung function testing, most GPs do not have spirometers. A lot of hospitals in these countries do not have spirometers. And even if they do, their technicians have very poor training on PFTs. Because I have seen a lung function test done going off for 1 second, 2 seconds, and then said acceptable. Okay? Some horror stories, I don't know, have the time here to talk about. Then on top of that, we say in our regulation, very clear, the chest X-ray is required to be reported according to the ILO classification. But the total number of standard flims, and they need a standard flim. You must have ILO standard flims. Total number of standard flims in this country is about 10. So no good mechanism. Well, we say the OHD can do this. However, the X-rays must be reported according to the ILO standard, but the standard flims not available. All right? And of course, OHDs also lack training in there. So in Asia, they started a whole initiative, like in the US, you have a B-reader scheme. In Malaysia, in Asia, the Japanese started an initiative to train Asian radiologists and occupational physicians on what is called the Asia B-reader scheme. So that's another challenge that's out there, but reading of radiographs. With regards to the medical practitioners, let's say even if they find a case, they are reluctant to notify. And why are they reluctant to notify? Because sometimes the patient will ask for confidentiality, and of course, the doctor will fear of being removed from the panel. We have a panel doctor system. Companies hire the doctor. Now, if the doctor goes and reports, next year no more the panel. It's into your bread and butter issue. So doctors very reluctant to notify. And my problem is not there. My problem is they don't notify. My policymakers don't believe there's a problem. Okay? So the authority is not convinced that there's a problem and not pushing for stricter legislation. So for me, there's been a challenge in the diagnosis of asbestos case related cases. Then diagnosis of mesothelioma, we are not picking it up. I am sure it is there. We are not picking it up because the pathologists are not having the right staining techniques, not using the right staining techniques to do it. And it's a challenge for those who know about mesothelioma. It is a challenge in the context of diagnosis, right? While I believe that down the road, asbestosis will go down, lung cancer and mesothelioma, I believe, will peak. Should peak by now, right? And of course, move towards getting compensation both from SOXO and from insurance companies. In closing, what I would like to recommend is one, we somehow, like this effort, I thought it would be a good opportunity for me, for those who are out here who are not aware about asbestos, to increase awareness of asbestos related disease. At least when you go back home, just ask this question, in my house, is there asbestos or not? All right? At least ask that question. And then, if I go, what do I do about it? That's the second part. And that's a more difficult one. What do I do about it? Sometimes they say ignorance is bliss. Just go on. Alright? The other one, of course, is to support the efforts by the workers union. In fact, the MTUC for many years was pushing for the ban. And I remember annually I used to go for the annual conference to present the keynote paper and talk about health issues, and particularly in one year I remember doing about asbestos. At the same time, get employers and their federations to understand what are the issues related to this. Most important for me as a trainer, as a teacher, is to train professionals. And finally, are we doing enough? Yes, we have done a lot. But the question is, to me, unless we ban asbestos import, it will still be there, and future generations will be exposed to asbestos, posing themselves at great risk for developing cancers. I'm more worried about the cancers not so much the asbestosis. Cancer is a theme. Thank you very much. Any questions here, Warren? I was definitely expecting a question from Warren. He's presenting something on mesothelioma tomorrow. Yeah, Warren? Warren at the back, yeah.
The peak in UK hasn't arrived yet. We're
yes.
10 years down the line. And that's 30 years after the ban was implemented. If mesothelioma is going to be controlled in Malaysia, and as you say, the reporting is very low, it's going to be decades before there's going to be a dip in the number of cases in the country. What do you think the government should do tomorrow? Should they implement the ban?
Basically, for me, one, of course, with regard to asbestos, it is a long time coming. They have to ban its import. Very clear. Two, what they need to do is also have better surveillance system for those who are already exposed to asbestos in the industry. There was a move by the Department of Safety and Health to get the industry, asbestos industry, at that time there were 10 companies, there are only now 3 asbestos cement companies in the country, to say now, you had exposed these workers in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, we would like you to fund a study, right, to look at this problem. And for you, you're also supposed to have the records, because under the asbestos process regulations, you already have the records to do that, not done. So basically, to me, I guess, increasing the awareness is very, very important. So the world move towards ban is there. And three, we also need to understand these issues better with regards to mesothelioma. You talk about latency period, 30 years, 40 years. The study being done by Ken Takashi and his group start with the 1968 window period, 30 to 40 years from that, and looking for the mesothelioma cases. Okay.
Any statistical data about mesothelioma and asbestos-related diseases in Malaysia?
Your guess is as good as mine. Very little. The numbers that we're talking about, 2-3 cases of mesothelioma a year, right? Some years no mesothelioma cases, which doesn't make sense to me. The lung cancer cases which are associated with mesothelioma, we say 5% of your lung cancer should be asbestos related. But again, if not reporting done, we just assume how many lung cancer cases we have, 1,000 let's say, and then we need to have the 5%, about 50 cases we expect to see. But 1,000 lung cancer cases in a year, we expect to see 50 cases. Not there. Nobody's reporting. Yes, Scott?
About 4 years ago, when I was looking for an apartment to rent, one of the things I was told was check that there are no fake ceilings. You know, Malaysians like to put fake ceilings in their apartments so that they have the cement at the top.
Plastic ceilings.
About 4 years ago, when I was renting an apartment, looking to rent an apartment, I was advised that you should look and check that there are no, rent an apartment with no fake ceilings. Is that a myth in terms of, I mean, you talk about asbestos being available in ceilings, tiles. Is there a difference between having it in a cement ceiling at the top or these fake ceilings that are created to add value to the house?
I would not worry about the plaster ceilings, right? Those plaster ceilings are safe. But what has happened is that if you look above it, right? And if they're old houses, new apartments do not worry too much about it. If they're expensive apartments, do not worry about it. 30% of our low-cost homes, 30% of our low-cost homes have asbestos ceilings in their houses. I remember I was telling you about a TV episode. During that episode, there was a director, the OSH doctor from NIOSH, myself, and this director from this company who is involved in building low-cost homes. And he said that's the only way we can go to cover our costs. So low-cost homes in this country continue to be using asbestos ceiling. The enlightened, the new condominiums, the Bangsa Souths and the Kumon Kiaras, please do not even worry about it. At the same time, the government itself in early 90s made a serious effort. What they said was any contractor making government buildings from the early 90s not to use asbestos anymore. So whatever you're seeing is, before 90s, buildings made in the 80s, 70s, 60s, you would see asbestos.
Okay, just one more question. You said that regardless of the threshold, you can still get disease if you're exposed to asbestos, but yet employers are advised to keep the time that workers are exposed to asbestos to a minimum.
Right.
Is that of any benefit?
See, this is the question. The asbestos industry continued to fight what is called the safe use of asbestos. Under the safe use of asbestos, what they had was provisions for what's called a permissible exposure limit and an action level. In Malaysia, under the factory submission asbestos regulation, there's 1 fiber per ml, right? Now it's 0.5, 1 fiber per ml. Right? In 2000, it became, from 1986, 1 fiber per ml, it was changed to 0.1 fiber per ml. But at the same time, we know for mesothelioma, any single, even any short exposure can. But the industry continues to push for that, and the government till today has not banned it.
Right, thank you, Prof. And that was a question from Prof. Skanta. I believe you have a question.
He already asked his.
Okay. Anyone else with a question?
Thank you, Prof. Rampal. I learned a lot about the asbestos, but my question is a little bit basic. Is there any genetic risk to mesothelioma? Because not all person exposed to asbestos develop this kind of cancer.
So, I guess just like any disease, and I guess I may have to refer to Abhi for this, because anything on question on genetics, you're not supposed to answer. You're supposed to refer to Abhi, in-house geneticist. But for all ends and purposes, when you're talking about the crocodile-like workers, 1/5 of them did develop mesothelioma. That's quite high. We all know not all smokers develop lung cancer, correct? But we know lung cancer, the risk of lung cancer is 10 times more among smokers versus non-smokers. So in the same context that's out there, not everybody is going to get disease, but 1/5 of prostate workers did get. Abhi, you want to add anything, or you're quite happy with that answer?
So anybody else?
Okay, it's time, I guess.
All right, thank you very much, Professor
Thank you
Rampal.
Very much for this.
Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming in for this event. I have to remind you that this is a bi-monthly luncheon address, so there'll be another similar kind of event in about 2 months' time. So, before your food grows moldy, I will let everyone go. If there's no other concern, your food will be served at the student lounge. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you in the next bi-monthly luncheon address, okay? Thank you very much.
Is it so sleepy?
Yeah, I've been working on it.
No, stop loss? Things. You should finish your sentence. Stop loss?
Yes, yes.